Let's discuss reservoir drive mechanism in this session. Oil reservoir drive mechanism. As we all know, for oil reservoir drive mechanism, when my oil is in undersaturated condition, at that time I can have a oil reservoir without bottom water drive, or I can have a oil reservoir with bottom water drive. Okay. Now, when my oil is saturated, pressure is less than my bubble point pressure, at that time I can have a depletion drive, I can have a gas cap drive, I can have a bottom water drive, and I can have a combination drive. Alright, but from that I can also have a gravity drainage. Okay. Alright, now coming to the drive mechanism, I have made this chart, okay, which shows different oil recovery for different drive mechanism. Okay, for rock and liquid expansion I have 3 to 7% of oil recovery. For solution gas drive I can have a 5 to 30% of oil recovery. For a gas cap drive I have a 20 to 40% of oil recovery. For water drive I have separated two separate things. For a bottom water drive I have 20 to 40%, and for a edge water drive I have a 40 to 60%. Why edge drive has more recovery than bottom drive, I will discuss it when I am discussing water drive mechanism. Gravity drainage has less than around 80% of recovery, and combination drive have around 30 to 60% of recovery. Okay, so whenever someone asks you ki which drive mechanism has the maximum oil recovery, then at that time your answer should be theoretically gravity drainage has the maximum oil recovery, but in field conditions it's actually water drive. Okay, in field it is actually the water drive which has the highest oil recovery. Okay, so this is a very important question as far as interviews are concerned. Now coming to where does the natural energy of a reservoir come. Okay, before that I should first discuss a petroleum system. So this is my petroleum system. As we all know, a petroleum system comprises of a mature source rock, migration pathway, reservoir rock, a trap and a seal. All right, as you all know, source rock means basically shale can act as a source rock, or sometimes even limestone can act as a source rock. Coming to migration, as you all know, migration can be divided into three parts: primary, secondary and tertiary migration, where primary migration means when my oil moves from my source rock to the reservoir rock, that's primary migration. Your secondary migration means when my oil or the hydrocarbon moves from the reservoir rock to a trap or a seal. So that's my secondary migration. And tertiary migration means when my hydrocarbon moves from the reservoir to from a reservoir to another reservoir, or from a trap to another trap, or from the reservoir to a, it has seeped to the surface. So that's the tertiary migration. All right. Now coming to reservoir rock, as you all know, a sandstone can act as a reservoir rock, or a limestone can act as a reservoir rock. All right. As source rock, again shale can be a source rock, and even limestone can sometimes be a source rock. Now coming to trap and seal. Okay, basically a low permeable rock. Generally it is a shale. Okay, it is also known as cap rock. Okay, basically seal means it is a low permeability layer. Okay, which acts as a cap rock. That means which does not allow the hydrocarbon to move past through it, or to flow past through it. Okay, so that's the seal. Now coming to trap, that it can be a structural trap or a stratigraphic trap. For a structural trap, you can have a fold or an anticline, fold, all right, or an anticline, or you can have a fault. Okay, now coming to stratigraphic traps, can be pinch out can be an example of stratigraphic trap. You unconformity or a reef. Okay, these three are the examples of a stratigraphic trap. All right, got it. So that's the difference between trap and seal. Now coming to where does the energy of a reservoir come. Okay, so energy may be coming from the liberation and expansion of a solution gas. It can be from the influx of an aquifer water. It can be due to the contraction of the reservoir rock. Okay, or compressibility, the property of compressibility is very important, so that can also act as a natural energy for reservoir. Or expansion of original reservoir fluids. Okay, for example, a free gas may be there, interstitial water or condensed water can be there, or oil if present. Okay, again, we all know these things get expanded when I reduce the reservoir pressure. All right, so that can also act as a natural energy for the reservoir, or even the gravitational force. Okay, even the gravitational force can act, can also, that gravitational forces means that the density difference, okay, the property of density difference can also be act for the natural energy of a reservoir. All right, coming to rock and liquid expansion drive. So when an oil reservoir initially exists at a pressure higher than its bubble point pressure, the reservoir is called a undersaturated oil reservoir. As we all know, at pressures above the bubble point pressure, crude oil, condensed water and rock are the only materials present. Obviously, as the reservoir pressure declines, the rock and the fluids expand due to their individual compressibilities. Got it? Okay. The reservoir rock compressibility is the result of two main factors. One is the expansion of the individual rock grains, and second is the formation compaction. Formation compaction, again, it may be due to overburden pressure. Got it? Okay. As the expansion of the fluids and the reduction in pore volume occur with the decreasing reservoir pressure, the crude oil and water will be forced out of the pore space to the wellbore. Because liquids and rocks are only slightly compressible, the reservoir will experience a rapid pressure decline. Okay, the oil reservoir under this driving mechanism is characterized by a constant GOR that is equal to the gas solubility of the bubble point pressure. This is a very, very important concept, okay, as far as rock and liquid expansion drive is concerned. Now, over here, two main points is the expansion of fluids and the reduction in pore volume. Okay, because of these two features, my rock and liquid expansion works, and that too, this rock and liquid expansion is only valid above my bubble point pressure. Okay, is only valid when my reservoir pressure is above my bubble point pressure. That is when I have an undersaturated condition. At that time, we will consider rock and liquid expansion. Again, very notable feature over here is my reservoir pressure will decline very fast. All right, my reservoir pressure will experience a rapid decline in the reservoir pressure. Okay, and the second thing is I will experience a constant GOR. Okay, these are the two characteristics, that is rapid decline in reservoir pressure and my rapid, and the GOR remains constant. Okay, so these are the two main features of my rock and liquid expansion. Okay, now again, my recovery was around 2 to 7%. Recovery factor is very much less. Recovery factor is only 2 to 7%. Okay, that is also a very important point to be taken into consideration. Now let's talk about solution gas drive, or in other words, it is also termed as depletion drive mechanism. Okay, so in this type of reservoir, the principal source of energy is a result of gas liberation from the crude oil and the subsequent expansion of the solution gas as the reservoir pressure is reduced. Very important point. As reservoir falls below the bubble point pressure, gas bubbles are liberated with the microscopic pore spaces. Okay, a very important point. It is a very important point. Again, above the bubble point, only liquid oil expansion occurs. Below the bubble point, both liquid oil expansion and gas expansion contributes to the volume change. Okay, this is a very important point over here. Now, let's look at the characteristics. Reservoir pressure. Let's look at the reservoir pressure. It declines rapidly and continuously. Okay, so from this particular chart, you can see that my reservoir pressure is decreasing very rapidly. See, my reservoir pressure is declining very rapidly. All right, so that's one of the trend when I observed in my solution gas drive. GOR, let's look at the trend of GOR. It increases to maximum and then declines. See, over here, in this case, you can see that it will go down. It will increase to maximum and then again decreases. Okay, I will discuss about this trend in coming up slide in pretty much detail. Now let's talk about water production. Water production is almost none. See, water production or water cut is almost none. Now coming to well behavior, requires pumping at early stage. Okay, recovery is 5 to 30%. Okay, now let's look at the location of if I'm planning for wells, or if I'm going for a field development. If I am going for a field development in a solution gas drive mechanism, in a reservoir with solution gas drive, at that time I will place my wells for example, if I am having a steep dip reservoir, so I will place my wells at the structurally low part of the flanks. See, I have kept my wells in the structurally low part, okay, of the flank of the reservoir. Let's say for this shallow deep well, again I will place my wells at the structurally low part of the reservoir. Of the reservoirs, okay. Structurally low is a very important term over here. Structurally low part. All right. Okay. Now let's look at this particular figure. So from this, you can see that initial condition there is no. Again, my reservoir pressure is above my bubble point, so you can see that there is no gas being dissolved over here. But during my depletion, you can see the gas bubbles are coming out. Okay, and my gas. After some time, I will also develop a free gas. Okay, after some time, I can develop a free gas in my reservoir also. All right. So again, one important point, you can see that my wells. You can see my placement of my wells. Okay, the perforation of the wells will be in the structurally low part of the reservoir. Got it? Okay. Now, again, let's look at this particular figure. Okay, from this figure, you can see that for above the bubble point, when my reservoir was in undersaturated condition, at that time, you can see the decrease of reservoir pressure. Okay, there is a rapid decline in the reservoir pressure. All right, and once when my reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point pressure, at that time, you can look at the trend of decline in reservoir pressure. The slope is less. Okay, that means comparatively, my decline will be less when my reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point pressure. Got it? Okay. Now, again, let's look at this particular figure. Okay. See, this is the original condition where there is oil and there is some sort of a water below, beneath my reservoir. Okay, so as I am producing, you can see the bubbles coming out. This is a partially depleted condition, and see, these bubbles are liberated solution gas. Okay, after some time, there are chances that it may, if there is high amount of liberated gas, it can also create a free gas condition. All right. Okay. Now, this dissolved gas reservoirs typically recover between 5 to 25% of the original oil in place and 60 to 80% of the gas in place. Okay. Okay. This is again a very crucial point. Now, why this particular gas is coming out? Okay. I have discussed in my nodal analysis session. Also, let me repeat it again over here. As we can see that my PI, when my initial condition, you can see my reservoir pressure was above the bubble point pressure. So above the bubble point pressure, this is my undersaturated region. This is my undersaturated region. And below the bubble point pressure, when my reservoir pressure goes below bubble point, it is my saturated region. All right. Okay. Now in the PT diagram, in this particular PT diagram, I have this phase envelope. Okay. And this 80%, 60%, 40%, 20% are the quality lines. These are the quality lines. Okay. For example, if I'm considering a quality line of 80%, that means 80% is my, I will have 80% of liquid, 80 liquid and 20 gas. Got it? All right. Now, in an isothermal way, my pressure is going down. So if someone asked me what's the definition of a bubble point, so that my answer would be the pressure and temperature at which the very first bubble of the gas is liberated in the reservoir. So that's my bubble point. See that when my reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point, see, as I'm declining my reservoir pressure, at that time, I will experience quality lines. I will pass through different quality lines. For example, 80%, 60% and 40%. Okay. So if I am going down at that time, you can see that I will be touching quality lines with lower liquid. Okay. Or with lower oil. So that's why you can see that I have high amount of gas coming out. Okay. Now coming to this particular figure, it is a very important figure. And very important gate concept also. For gate, this is a very important concept. So please take special note regarding that. Okay. Now, as we all can see, this is this graph is valid for solution gas only, for solution gas drive reservoir, for solution gas drive reservoir or a depletion drive reservoir. This particular graph is valid. All right. Again, a very important gate level concept. Now you can see that this is my initial reservoir pressure. This is my bubble point pressure. Okay. And see, above the bubble point, my declining reservoir pressure is very high. And below the bubble point, you can see there will be declining reservoir pressure, but comparatively, it will be less. All right. Okay. Now you can see the very important thing over here is the trend of GOR curve. The GOR curve, you can see that above the bubble point it remains the same, okay, and after that you can see that it is decreasing. Okay, I can see a decrease in the bubble point, and after 0.3 to 4 you can see an increase in the GOR trend, okay, and from 4 to 5 you can see again a decrease in GOR. Why this particular decrease occurs, let's discuss in detail. Now the formula for GOR calculation is this: GOR is equal to RS, where RS is my gas solubility, into KR upon KRG upon KRO, where KRG is my relative permeability to gas, KRO is my relative permeability to oil, into mu into BO upon mu G into BG. BO is my oil formation volume factor, BG is my gas formation volume factor, and mu is my oil viscosity and mu G is my gas viscosity. All right, okay. Now let's look at this. See, this is my GOR, this is my gas oil rel pump. So in this rel pump you can see in the saturation scale I have a saturation of gas. So you can see that with time my oil will go down, with time my oil production will go down, and my gas production will rise up. All right, so this is the trend of my rel pump. All right, so you can see that, very clearly see that even a small saturation of gas, see even a very small saturation of a gas, I can see a rapid decline in the oil permeability. Okay, that means a small saturation of gas will lead to a rapid decline in my oil relative permeability. You can see it very clearly. All right, okay, now let's look at this particular figure. Is a very beautiful figure for solution gas concept. What is a solution gas? Okay, it is the number of SCF of gas, okay, number of SCF of gas dissolved in 1 STB of oil. Okay, again, number of SCF of gas dissolved in 1 STB of oil. Okay, 1 STB means 1 stock time barrel of oil. How much number of my standard cubic feet of gas is dissolved? Okay, so that's the definition of solution gas. So you can see from this particular diagram, see where this green indicates barrel of oil. Okay, when in the reservoir condition I am not having any sort of gas been liberated, but as you have seen in my nodal analysis session also, you can see that as my reservoir fluid takes the journey from the reservoir to the tubing, I can see two phases coming out. Okay, the gas and the liquid is being separated. So at this separator I am separating this oil and I am separating the gas. Okay, so this red part indicates my solution gas, and since I in the reservoir I don't have any sort of free gas, so whatever gas is coming out is my solution gas. So you can see, and the green part indicates my oil. So this is the formula of this is a unit of solution gas, where it is the number of SCF of gas dissolved in 1 STB of oil. Again, this red indicates gas and green indicates oil. This is a very beautiful representation of solution gas concept. All right, okay, now let's discuss this particular graph. As we all know, above the bubble point my FVF will see, if I'm looking at this in this particular direction, if I'm looking, let's look at the trend of my formation volume factor. See, it is rising till this point, and below this point it is going down. Okay, again, as we all know, the unit of FVF or formation volume factor is reservoir barrel to stock tank barrel. All right, now again, we all know that above the bubble point whatever gas is present in my oil, it is trying to come out. Okay, it is trying to liberate, but since it is above the bubble point, instead of liberating it will try to expand the oil. There is an increase in my BO above the bubble point, and once it goes below the bubble point you can see that my gas will start to liberate out. Okay, now because of that liberation of gas, my BO will go down. All right, so that's BO for you. Again, I have explained this thing in my nodal analysis session. Now let's discuss about this particular RS or solution gas. In the RS, above the bubble point will be a straight line, okay, because all the gas is dissolved, is in dissolved state. Okay, that means there is no free gas being liberated. So that's why above the bubble point my solution gas will be in dissolved state and it will be a straight line, and once the reservoir pressure goes below the bubble point, at that time I can see that my RS will decrease. Okay, because my from the crude oil my gas is getting liberated, so as a result my solution gas trend is going down below the bubble point, as my reservoir pressure decreases. All right, okay. Now let's look at the let's look at this viscosity trend, oil viscosity trend. You can see that my oil viscosity is reducing above the bubble point, and below the bubble point my oil viscosity is increasing as I'm decreasing the pressure. Again, the same reason, above the bubble point the gas is trying to swell the oil. As a result, the viscosity of the oil is reducing as I'm reducing the pressure. This is the case above the bubble point. Okay, and once below the bubble point, if my reservoir pressure has gone, at that time the gas is trying to come out. Okay, all the lighter components are escaping from the crude oil. As a result, whatever left behind is a heavier mass, and whatever left behind will have a higher viscosity. Got it? Okay. Now coming to this particular graph, which is which shows my BG versus P, that is formation volume factor of gas versus my pressure. Okay, again the unit of BG would be standard reservoir cubic feet of gas upon cubic feet of gas at the surface. All right, so you can see that as I am increasing my pressure, my BG will decrease. Okay, if I'm looking at this in this particular region, if as I'm increasing my pressure, my BG will decrease. Got it. Let's look at this again. Let's go to this graph only again. So these are points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Now from point 1 to 2, from point 1 to 2, I am above my bubble point pressure. That means my reservoir pressure is above the bubble point pressure. There is no free gas in the reservoir, obviously, because it's above the bubble point pressure. And my relative permeability of gas is zero. All right. Again, no gas has been liberated. So that's why my relpum of relative permeability of gas is zero, and my GOR is equal to RSI is equal to RSB. Okay, see, my GOR would be equal to RSI. So you can see above the bubble point, that is from RSI, this point to this point, RSB, I have a constant solution GOR. Okay, so my GOR, whatever GOR is, whatever instantaneous GOR I have, it is RSI is equal to RSB. So that's why I can see a straight line. I can see a straight line over here. Now let's reduce my pressure further down. Now from point 2 to 3. Okay, that means now from at point 2 is my bubble point pressure, and if I am reducing the reservoir pressure, so what happens? Let's see. So you can see that my gas begins to evolve from the solution. Obvious. Note, very important note, very very crucial point. Till my saturation of gas is greater than the saturation of critical gas saturation. Okay, that is till my saturation of gas is greater than the critical gas saturation is not achieved, gas will not flow. Okay, till my SG don't overcome my SGC, that is the critical gas saturation, if this condition is not achieved, till that point the gas will not flow in my reservoir. SGC means my critical gas saturation, and the definition is the minimum gas saturation below which my gas will not flow, and the trend of my, okay, so that's my definition of SGC. Now my decreasing gas solubility, as you can see that once below the bubble point my gas solubility will decrease. Okay, you can see that, see, from 2 to from point 2 to 3 you can see my GOR is going down. Okay, again this funda is because of my SGC region. That means my saturation of gas has not gone above my SGC, so that's why I can see a definite decrease in the GOR. Okay, all right. Now let's talk about point 3 to 4. Point 3 to 4, from this point onwards my free gas begins to flow. Okay, and you can see a definite increase in GOR. See, from point 3 to 4 my free gas has start to develop. That means my saturation of gas has gone above the critical gas saturation, so my free gas has started to flow. So you can see my GOR is increasing. Got it? Till point 4. Now let's go further. Now 4 to 5. Point 4 to 5. At point 4, this is my maximum GOR possible. All right, this is a maximum GOR possible. And from 4 to 5, the phase is known as blowdown phase. Okay, this is a very important term in production engineering. So point 4 to 5, where I again see a decrease in the GOR, so that's that particular phase is termed as blowdown phase. Got it? Okay, and at point 5, all the producible free gas has been produced. That's it. Okay, so this is a trend of my GOR. All right, and it's a very important concept, gate level concept. Okay, So you need to take special note regarding this. And again, this particular formula is also very important. And I think numerical related to this formula has already been asked. So very important concept. Okay. And remember this particular formula and the concept also. Okay. Let's go further. Let's talk about gas cap drive. Gas cap drive reservoirs can be identified by the presence of gas cap with little or no water drive. Due to the ability of the gas cap to expand, these reservoirs are characterized by a slow decline in the reservoir pressure. The natural energy available to produce the crude oil comes from the following two sources. Let's look at the sources of natural energy. One is the expansion of gas cap itself, and second is the expansion of solution gas as it is liberated. All right. One is the gas cap itself, and second is the solution gas that is getting liberated, which is very obvious. All right. Okay. Now let's look at the trends. Let's look at the some of the trends. Let's look at reservoir pressure first. The reservoir pressure falls slowly and continuously. Pressure trends to be maintained at a higher level than in a depletion level. Depletion drive. Okay. Compared to a depletion drive, my pressure decline will be less. The degree of pressure maintenance depends upon the volume of gas in the gas cap compared to the oil volume. Which is again very obvious. If I am having a gas cap, okay. If I am having a high gas cap, that means let's say this value of M. Okay. That means my gas, if the value of M, I will discuss this M value in my material balance session. So M is equal to initial gas cap versus upon initial oil in place. Okay, I will discuss this in detail in my material balance session. So if my value of M is more, okay, that means my decline in reservoir pressure will also be less. Okay, that means if my value of M is more, that means I have more gas cap. I have more volume of gas cap. Okay, so my decline in reservoir pressure will be less. Now, let's talk about water production. It is almost, see, in the trend also you can see my reservoir pressure is declining, but the decline is comparatively less. Now talking about water production, it is almost absent or negligible water production. See the water production, it is almost negligible. Talking about GOR, the GOR rises continuously in upstructure wells. Okay. Again, in upstructure means if I am having this reservoir, okay, and whatever wells, if my wells are perforated in this case, so this is my upstructure well. Okay. Upstructure well. Okay. So in the upstructure well, there will be a definite increase in GOR continuously. As the expanding gas cap reaches the producing intervals of upstructure wells, the GOR ratio from the affected wells will increase to high values. Okay. So again, the ultimate recovery is 20-40% as we have seen earlier. Okay. Now let's look at the positioning of wells. If I'm told to position a well. Okay. So this is the top view or the map view of my gas cap reservoir. Okay. So look at the position of the wells. It is whenever I'm having this kind of a reservoir or a gas cap reservoir, let's say this is my reservoir, this is my gas cap. Okay. So what I will do is I will always try to place my wells in the structurally low part. That means I will always try to be at the structurally low part. Okay. The reason is, as we all know, with time, my gas cap will increase. Okay. With time, my gas cap is going to increase. Okay. And if my perforations are way below down, that means I can control my GOR to some extent. Okay, that means if my particular well is producing high amount of GOR, that is not desirable for us. Okay, we need high amount of GOR means gas to oil ratio. We need more oil. Okay, when you're talking about GOR, it is the gas to oil ratio. Okay, we need more oil, not gas. Okay, so that's why what we will do is we will try to perforate in the bottommost part of the reservoir. Okay, again, it is obvious that my gas is always trying to expand. My gas cap will always try to expand by itself. Okay. So that's why it is always preferable to have a well in the structurally low part, as low as possible. I will place a well. Okay. I will place a well as low as possible. And my perforation also I will keep as low as possible. Okay. Done. Now let's particular graph is for abundant reservoir pressure versus abundant pressure. So you can see that as my gas cap value or my value of M is for different values of M, you can see my abundant pressure is rising. Okay. As my value of M is rising, my abundant pressures are also rising. Okay. Now let's discuss water drive reservoirs. So many reservoirs are bounded on a portion or all the peripheries by a water bearing rocks called aquifers. Okay, the aquifers may be so large compared to the reservoir that they adjoin as to appear infinite for all practical purposes. The aquifer itself may be entirely bounded by impermeable rocks, so that the reservoir and the aquifer together form a closed volumetric unit. Alright, so you can have an infinite reservoir or a finite reservoir. Okay, now let's look at the different characteristics observed. Reservoir pressure, it remains high. That means there is hardly any decline in reservoir pressure. This is a very important point. Surface GOR, it remains low. Comparatively, the GOR is low. Water production starts early and increases to appreciable amount. Okay, water cut will be very, very high. Well behavior, flow until water production gets excessive. Okay, over here if I want to terminate the well, so I will have, let's say, it depends on the company's policy whether to terminate the well after above 98%. If whatever wells goes above 98% of water cut, okay, that means I will abandon the particular well. Okay. Expected oil recovery, it is 35 to 75%. Again, it is different for a water dry with bottom water or dry with edge water. Okay, so we will discuss that in coming up slides. See, my reservoir pressure is hardly going down, you can see very clearly. My water cut is rising very quickly and my produced GR is almost constant. See, produced GR is almost constant and my recovery factor is 30 to 70%. All right now if I'm told to locate the well, let's say in a field development, in the field development process, let's say if I am planning to drill wells in a field with water drive reservoirs, water drive mechanism, at that time I will always try to place my wells in the top part, in the structurally low part. Sorry, in the structurally, I will always try to keep my wells in the structurally high points. Okay, that means, let's say in this particular flank, of the reservoir where I have a water drive beneath, at that time I will always try to keep my wells in the top, in the structurally high portions. Okay, also let's say this is a particular reservoir with shallow dip, at that time also you can see the well positions or the perforations of the well are in the structurally high points. Okay, so that's the location of wells, which this is a very important concept when we are looking for well development. Okay, now let's look at a water drive in detail. So you can see water drive can be a bottom water, can be edge water or a linear inflex. Generally these two terms are found, bottom water and edge water. You can see this is a very beautiful concept. Take a special note regarding this. This is the schematic example of fingering in water drive reservoir. Okay, so as I mentioned, my edge water will always have a greater recovery factor as compared to that of a bottom water drive. So the main concept behind this is that the concept of fingering. Okay, because of fingering, my recovery factor of edge water is more than bottom water. So you can see that. Let's see. So very beautifully it has been mentioned in this particular diagram. So this is the aquifer. This is the aquifer part and this is the oil part. I have drilled two wells in the structurally high points and I am producing. Okay. Now when I am producing with time, you can see that there are globules of oils that are left behind. Okay. See, there are globules of oils that is left behind. Okay, because of fingering, because of the process of fingering, my oils are being left behind. Okay, over here you can see, since my bottom water drive, since I am having bottom water drive, at that time you can see the surface area of my water touching my oil layer. Okay, whatever surface area my water is having contact with the oil is very large. Okay, that means larger the surface area, so I will have larger oil globules being left behind. Okay, very simple concept. Larger the area I have in contact with the oil layer, that means more amount of oil globules will be left behind. Okay, that means more amount of fingering will be there. Okay, that's why my recovery factor is less. Let's look at edge water drive. Okay, so you can see that in my edge water drive, there is this globules being left out. See, this green portion are the oil. Okay, so there you can definitely see oil globules being left out or the process of fingering taking place. But you can see that since my area of contact of my water with the oil layer is less, so because of that my overall all globules being left out is less, or my fingering process occurring is less. That's why my recovery factor in an edge water drive is more. That is around 40 to 60% as compared to that of a bottom water drive with a recovery factor of 20 to 40%. Okay, so that's a very important concept and it's a very gate level question. Okay, now let's look at the different flow regimes. As we all know, flow regimes, we have three different type of flow regimes, which is the steady state, semi steady state and unsteady state. Steady state means my dp by dt is equal to zero. Okay, that is my change in pressure with time will be zero. For a semi steady state, my change in pressure with time will be constant, and in unsteady state, my change in pressure with time depends on the, it's a function of my distance of the well from the reservoir, distance of the, it depends on the distance as well as time. Okay, let's look at this particular, this is a rectangular reservoir. Let's take example over here. This is a rectangular reservoir and I have a well at this particular point. Okay, if I'm talking about a steady state condition, okay, steady state condition, dp by dt is zero. That means throughout the life of the reservoir, at any point in the reservoir, my pressure will always remain the same. Throughout the life of the reservoir, at any point, my reservoir pressure will remain the same. Okay, that means there will be no change in pressure at all. Okay, this particular type of trend will be obtained when I have an infinite support. I will have this kind of a dp by dt is equal to zero or steady state condition. Got it? Okay. There is a, let's say I have a limited boundary. I have a limited support. At that time, dp by dt is equal to constant. dp by dt is equal to constant. This means that with time, let's say at time t1, I have a reservoir pressure p1. Okay. That means at time t1, at all the points in the reservoir, I have same reservoir pressure. Okay. And at time t2, my pressure would be decrease towards p2, point p2. Okay. And this change in decrease will be constant throughout. Okay. And my pressure will remain the same throughout the reservoir point. At any point in the reservoir, my reservoir pressure will remain the same. But with time, the decrease in reservoir pressure will also be same throughout the reservoir. Okay. So that is dp by dt is equal to constant or the semi steady state condition. Now let's look at the unsteady state condition. Okay. Unsteady state condition over here means my dp by dt is a function of distance and time. Okay. That means at any point, that means you won't be having same reservoir pressure at all the points in the reservoir. Okay. That means at this point, there will be different reservoir pressure. At this point, there will be different reservoir pressure. At this term, there will be different reservoir pressure. Okay. And also the change in reservoir pressure is also different. So that's unsteady state condition for you guys. Okay. Now let's look at the outer boundary condition. Outer boundary condition, you can have an infinite support or a limited support. Infinite support means that is meant throughout the life of the reservoir, my reservoir pressure will remain the same because there is a constant source of reservoir. And limited means, that means limited source means I cannot have a constant source of reservoir pressure throughout my life. So that's the limited outer boundary condition. Okay. Now let's move further. Let's discuss combination drive. Two combinations of driving forces can be present in combination drive, and these are depletion drive and a weak water drive. And second is depletion drive with a small gas cap and a weak water drive. All right. So these are the two cases where my combination drive is found. So let's look at the trends. Reservoir pressure. If I'm looking at reservoir pressure, there would be relatively rapid pressure decline, as compared to that of a water drive. Water encroachment and or external gas cap expansion are insufficient to maintain reservoir pressures. Talking about the water production, water encroaching slowly into the lower part of the reservoir. Structurally low producing wells will exhibit slowly increasing water production rates. Okay, that means whichever wells are positioned in the structurally low part, okay, that means slowly and steadily I will get an increase in water production. So that's the term. Let's talk about GOR. If a small gas cap is present, the structurally high wells will exhibit continually increasing GOR. This is very obvious. Okay. Now, if I'm having a gas cap and in structurally low wells, at that time, I will definitely see a continuous increase in my GUR, which is obvious. Provided the gas cap is expanding, it is possible that the gas cap will shrink due to production of excess free gas, in which case the structurally high wells will exhibit a decreasing GUR. This condition should be avoided whenever possible, as large volumes of oil can be lost as a result of shrinkage of gas cap. Okay, this shrinking of gas cap is also a very important term, and we will discuss this particular term of shrinking of gas cap in coming up sessions of material balance. The ultimate recovery is 30 to 60%. Okay, all right. Now again, based on the field development, whenever you are going for a field development, at that time we need to take special attention. And if a reservoir is having a combination drive, that in that time my location of wells, that means my placement of wells, should be very important when we are discussing field development concept. And if I'm looking at the map view of combination drive, you can see that my I can see my gas cap, I can see my oil zone, and this is my water basin. This is a very beautiful map view representation of the combination drive. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss gravity drainage drive. The mechanism of gravity drainage occurs in petroleum reservoirs as a result of differences in density of the reservoir fluids. Okay, by virtue of this difference in density, this drainage or this gravity drainage exists. Okay, now let's look at the trends. Reservoir pressure, the reservoir to be operated solely as a result of gravity drainage, the reservoir would show a rapid pressure decline. Very important term. This would require the upstructure migration of the evolved gas, where it later would be produced from structurally high wells, resulting in rapid loss of pressure. Okay, this is a very important point. You can see that with time, as I'm producing, my gas is trying to go up by virtue of my density difference. My gas is trying to go up to this point, to the structurally high part. My gas is trying to go up. So that's what this particular thing. So we need to be extra careful while we are placing the wells in a gravity drainage drive reservoir. Okay. Now looking at the GUR trend, low GUR from structurally low wells, obvious. This is caused by the migration of evolved gas up structure due to gravity segregation of the fluids. Again, obvious. On the other hand, the structurally high wells will experience an increasing GUR as a result of the upstructure migration of the gas released from the crude oil. Very crucial point. Now let's talk about the secondary gas cap. Formation of a secondary gas cap in reservoirs that initially were undersaturated. Obviously, the gravity drainage mechanism does not become operative until reservoir pressure has declined below the saturation pressure. Since above the saturation pressure, there will be no free gas in the reservoir. Okay, and again, this point indicates that my gravity drainage will only come into action when I have gone for a reserve, when I have a saturated reservoir condition. At that time only this particular system will be applicable. Now let's talk about the water production. Little or no water production. Water production is indicative of a water drive. Now ultimate recovery is almost 80%. So theoretically, this particular gravity drainage is as the maximum. Theoretically, it has the maximum recovery factor. But if you are talking about field, and in field, it's the water drive that has the maximum recovery factor. Okay. Now let's discuss further. I have compared reservoir performance of different drive mechanism. So you can see that my pressure versus cumulative oil produced. This is the reservoir pressure I'm talking about. So you can see that if I'm comparing all the three, in solution gas cap drive, my reservoir pressure is going down, or my rapid decline in reservoir pressure. In gas cap, as I'm producing more amount of oil, as my oil in place, as my percentage oil in place is increasing, at that time I can see my pressure decline is comparatively less as compared to solution gas drive. And for a water drive, my pressure decline is almost nil, or my pressure is almost constant throughout. Okay, again, this trend is with produced volume. Okay, that means over here on my y-axis I have a pressure term, and on the x-axis I have a produced volume. Or else time, or with time. Okay, again, let's discuss GUR versus percentage oil in place produced, or with time. Okay, now you can see GUR for a water drive is almost constant. Okay, for a gas cap, you can see it is constantly rising. And for solution gas cap, you can see initially there will be a decrease and then there will be increase and again it will decrease. I have explained this concept in detail. Now let's discuss water cut, trend of water cut versus percentage oil produced or time. So obviously water dry will have the maximum water cut, followed by gas cap and solution gas. Okay, now let's discuss oil rate versus percentage oil in place or time. Again, this concept I have explained in my decline curve analysis. I can see, I know the value of B. Okay, I know the value of B, where B is my hyperbolic constant. Now for water drive, the decline will be less. For gas cap, comparatively it will be more, and for solution gas I will have a maximum decline rate. Again, my value of B is increasing this side. Okay, for solution gas cap, I have 0.1 to 0.4 range of B. For gas cap, I have 0.5 value of B, and for the B value for water drive is greater than 0.5. Okay. Now let's discuss gas reservoir drive mechanism. Till now we have discussed oil reservoir drive mechanism. Now let's discuss gas reservoir drive mechanism. For a gas reservoir, you can see I have two types of drive mechanism. That is a volumetric reservoir, that is with a gas expansion drive, and second is a water drive gas reservoir. Volumetric reservoir means by virtue of gas. Okay, as we all know, the gas, if in a gas reservoir, if I am trying to reduce the reservoir pressure, at that time gas will try to expand itself. Okay, so because of that particular phenomenon, I can have a volumetric reservoir. Okay, so you can see the range of recovery factor. Average recovery factor is around 80% to 90% for a volumetric reservoir. And for a water drive reservoir, there's a beautiful catch over here. The average recovery factor is 50% and my range is 35 to 60%. That means in gas reservoir, my volumetric reservoir has more recovery factor as compared to that of a water drive. Okay, very, very important concept. It is a gate level question, gate level concept. Okay. For a gas reservoir, my volumetric reservoir drive or my gas expansion drive has more recovery factor as compared to that of a water drive. Okay, when I was discussing oil reservoir, at that time we were seeing that my water drive was having the maximum recovery. Theoretically, gravity drainage was having the maximum recovery, but still my water drive had a huge amount of recovery factor. But over here, it's the gas expansion drive or the volumetric reservoir that has a higher recovery factor as compared to that of water drive. Okay, we will discuss this particular concept in coming up slide. So when you're talking about gas reservoir, I can have a gas, pure gas reservoir without bottom water drive. And second thing, I can have a gas reservoir with bottom water drive. Okay, now let's discuss further. Now let's discuss this volumetric gas reservoir. Volumetric gas reservoirs are essentially depleted by the expansion, very important term. And therefore, the ultimate gas recovery is independent of the field production rate. The gas saturation in this type of reservoir is never reduced. See, again, very important point. The gas saturation is never reduced. Only the number of pounds of gas occupying the pore spaces is reduced. Only the pounds of gas occupying the particular pore space is getting reduced. But the gas saturation is not reducing at all. Therefore, it is important to reduce the abandonment pressure to the lowest possible level. In closed gas reservoirs, the recovery factor is 80% of the initial gas in place. Okay, the average is around 80%. Now let's talk about abandonment pressure. Abandonment pressure is a major factor in determining the recovery efficiency, and permeability is usually the most important factor in determining the magnitude of the abandonment pressure. Again, abandonment pressure is the minimum pressure of the reservoir till which we can run the well, or till which we can produce the particular well in the reservoir. Okay. Now reservoirs with low permeability will have higher abandonment pressure than the reservoir with higher permeability, which is very obvious. Than the reservoir with high permeability. Okay. This is again very obvious point. If my reservoir is having low permeability, my abandonment pressure will be high as compared to that of a reservoir with high permeability. A certain minimum flow rate must be sustained, and a higher permeability will permit this minimum flow rate at a lower pressure. Okay, very obvious point. Again, everything works by virtue of the expansion, the property of expansion of gas on reducing the reservoir pressure. Now let's discuss this gas reservoirs with water drive. Because gas often is bypassed and trapped by the encroaching water, recovery factors for gas reservoirs with water drive can be significantly lower than for volumetric reservoirs produced by simple gas expansion. In addition, the presence of reservoir heterogeneity such as low permeability, stringers or layering may reduce the gas recovery factor. Very, very important point. See, this point itself has given us the reason. Okay, why this recovery factor of water drive gas reservoir is less as compared to that of a volumetric. Okay, because you can see that these red portions are the bypassed gases. Okay, these red portions are the bypassed gases. So, as I'm producing, water will encroach and this gas will get bypassed. Okay. And again, we know my gas mobility is very large. My gas mobility is very large. Okay. It's very much large. Okay. And because of that, there will be high amount of bypassing. Okay. And let's say if I'm comparing it with a particular reservoir, let's say this is my gas reservoir. This is my gas reservoir. Okay. And let this be the water drive. Okay, let me compare this for a. So this was for a bottom water drive case. Okay. Let me discuss for a edge water drive. For that, you can see that even in this case also, my recovery factor would be comparatively more. Let's say these are my gas being bypassed. If I am going for an edge water drive, gas reservoir, at that time, my overall bypassing of gas will be lesser. Okay, you can see very clearly, my overall bypassing of the gas is comparatively lesser as that of a bottom water drive. So in this case also, if my gas reservoir as a edge drive water, my overall recovery factor will be more. Okay. Now, it's a rule of thumb, recovery from a water drive reservoir will be approximately 50 to 80% of the initial gas in place. The structural location of producing wells and the degree of water coning are important considerations in determining ultimate recovery. Okay. Now, let's say if in this case, if I am told to locate the well, ideal location for well, then I would go for a structurally high point. Okay. Structurally high point would be my ideal location for such kind of reservoir. Okay. Because again, over here, water coning will play a very important part. All right. Now, the encroaching water, however, reduces the initial gas saturation. Therefore, the high abandonment pressure is somewhat offset by the reduction in initial gas saturation. If the reservoir can be produced at a rate greater than the rate of water influx rate without water coning, then a high producing rate could result in maximum recovery by taking advantage of a combination of reduced abandonment pressure and reduction in initial gas saturation. Okay, very important point. Yeah, very important point over here. Here, reduced abandonment pressure and reduction in initial gas saturation plays a very important part. Okay. Now, second, the water coning problems may be very severe in gas reservoirs, in which case it will be necessary to restrict withdrawal rates to reduce the magnitude of this problem. Okay. So, that's all about gas reservoirs with water drive.